came out of our interviews with rural respondents. They hear the actions of the local elite featured far more as a source of injustice. Although local government was a problem, corruption was recognized, but there were many aspects where government had a much more positive manifestation. Government has promoted education for poor households, scholarships for girls, social protection for the poor, pensions for the elderly, and all of this is in the countryside. There's been decentralization, so it's much easier for poor people to stand for elections or to reach out to elected officials. So we didn't get quite the rage with government that we heard in the urban areas. And many of, because we were talking to members of the socially oriented NGOs, they were extremely articulate about their rights in a way that we did not hear in the urban areas. So here is a BRAC member talking about how they help to solve disputes within the community. And if they can't solve it themselves, they go to the law. People know that they're capable of solving disputes, and they have started to replace the traditional leaders in conflict resolution. Here's a guy who's talking about his rights. It is the state's responsibility to find our basic needs. Earlier, we didn't have proper treatment. We now put pressure on the union, the elected chairman, who will talk to the doctors so that we provide better medical care. Well, but they still have. Okay. This is another organization in Tripoli where this man is saying the greatest achievement from membership of this organization is awareness. Before we were scared to even talk to the guard, now we know the reason for our fears and people talk to them. And I found that a very revealing statement. And here's a woman from BRAC saying that although she had formal secondary education, she learned much more from her training in BRAC. She learned about the environment. She learned that the tree is the dearest friend of human being. The education she had got in school was simply to tell her to serve her husband. But she said a woman can do so much more than just serving her husband. She can work as hard as a man. And this is Shomoka, another social mobilization organization. We didn't know what a Hana Mirahi officer is a local official. Now we talk to these people. We protest, we garao, we surround, we go out for sessions. Now we can talk alongside these powerful people. We make sure there's proper treatment in hospitals. When they know we're from this particular language group, they give us much more respect than they used to. And we have demonstrated against corruption amongst doctors and so on. So it's a very different narrative that was coming out in the countryside. So at one level, of course, these contrasting narratives between urban and rural areas reflected the very purpose of selection that we did, that we chose to go for socially oriented organizations in the countryside, whereas we went with trade unions and microfinance organizations. But at another level, it wasn't accidental. The fact is that social mobilization organizations find it quite hard to mobilize in urban areas. Trade unions don't do it. They have been bought by the system. But these social mobilization organizations, because people are constantly being evicted and moving around, it is quite hard for them to organize in urban areas. So it wasn't accidental that we ended up looking at microfinance and trade unions in urban areas and social-oriented organizations in the countryside. But it did mean that we had no idea about whether microfinance organizations in the countryside would look different. Was there something about the countryside, you know, with a more responsive state that might mean that microfinance organizations in the countryside might have a different set of relationships, you know, not a minimal set of relationships, but something more deep and profound in stable conditions in the countryside? So the second part of the research, therefore, was to ask the question that was raised by the first part. And that is, if we look at rural areas alone, do we find any difference in the impact that different kinds of organizations have in terms of citizenship, rights, awareness, and so on? And by deciding to focus on social mobilization, donor funding. So to do research on the developing NGO sector is also to do research on donor policies, donor priorities, donor politics. Now, the rise and rise of the developing NGO sector reflects a number of phases in donor thinking. The first was the critique, the neoliberal critique of the bloated rent-seeking state, and the view that private provision of services would be far more efficient and equitable. And where there were no markets, then NGOs seemed to be the best service providers. But then there was a second phase in the 1990s, when with the 1989 issues, the rise of society, etc., questions about the quality of governance came onto the donor agenda, and efforts to make the state more accountable to its citizens. Here, Robert Putnam's ideas have been very influential. And he provided a very strong theoretical rationale for the central place assigned to civil society within this emerging good governance agenda. In his view, participation in the voluntary associations of civil society generated social capital in the form of trust, norms of reciprocity, and networks of civic engagement, which would then be harnessed to create democratically accountable governments. Such associations, according to Putnam, do not have to be overtly political. They can be choral societies or bird-watching societies. They can be Boy Scouts, they can be bowling groups. It was the density of civil society association that matters for these positive outcomes. Donors picked up these ideas of Putnam as a way of promoting civil society, but once again, it seems that their notion of civil society became equated with development NGOs. Putnam's position is, of course, a somewhat different one from the one I outlined earlier when we talked about the nature of associations being important in shaping identity and practices. For him, it is the density of associations rather than the specific characteristics. And Putnam's ideas are also very different from the radical groups of society, which sees it as a sphere of conflict over competing ideas and interests, separate from but interacting with the state, powers of the state. So not something that holds the state accountable, but something that is often very enmeshed with the power structures of society, including the state. And therefore including both the darker forms of social capital, such as patron-client relationships, the mafia, and so on, as well as the more positive forms of government about. So civil society then, in this view, has to be seen as composed of a diversity of associations, some of which are cooperated with or co-opted by the state and power structures, others seeking to challenge it. In this view, therefore, NGOs cannot be seen a priori as a good thing, as the donor discourse had it, but they would have to be judged on the basis of their performance and achievements. Now, some of the best-known NGOs in Bangladesh actually began out within the radical tradition. This goes for BRAC, it goes for Nizamuri, Shoulda, which we talked about. It goes for ASHA, today the most successful microfinance in the world, according to Forbes magazine. These all began out in the 70s, influenced by Paulo Freire, seeking to mobilize and conscientize the poor, seeking to use the power of mobilization to radically transform the structures of society. However, that was in the 70s. As the military government came into power, the scope for radical engagement started to shrink. And then, of course, donor funding came on board, and we saw an explosion of NGOs in Bangladesh. But interestingly, donor funding was concentrated on just a few. And they in turn funded the others. A study of 11 of the largest NGOs in Bangladesh found that of the 1,250 NGOs that received donor funding, 75% of the funding goes on the three largest NGOs, ASHA, BRAC, and Pushita. This pattern of favoring larger NGOs actually reflected another pressure on donors, which was to reduce work. Transcription